Mrs. Pierce, you're a woman. Why can't a woman be more like a man? Men are so decent, such regular chaps, ready to help you through any mishaps, ready to buck you up whenever you are glum. Why can't a woman be a chum? Why is thinking something women never do? And why is logic never even tried? Straightening up their hair is all they ever do. Why don't they straighten up the mess that's inside? Why can't a woman behave like a man? If I was a woman who'd been to a ball, been hailed as a princess by one and by all, would I start weeping like a bathtub overflowing? Or carry on as if my home were in a tree? Would I run off and never tell me where I'm going? Why can't a woman be like me?
Do you
mean imposter, that humbug, that toadying ignoramus? Teach him my methods, my discoveries. You take one step in that direction and I'll wring your neck.
Ring away, what do I care? I knew you'd strike me one day. Ah, that's done you, Henry Higgins, it has. Now I don't care that for your bullying and your big talk. What a fool I was, what a dominated fool, to think you were the earth and sky. What a fool I was, what an addlepated fool, what a mutton-headed dolt was I. Now, my reverberating friend, you are not the beginning and the end.
You impudent hussy. There's not an idea in your head or a word in your mouth that I haven't put there.
There'll be spring every year without you. England still will be here without you. There'll be fruit on the tree and a shore by the sea. There'll be crumpets and tea without you. Art and music will thrive without you. Somehow Keats will survive without you. And there still will be rain on that plain down in Spain. Even that will remain without you. I can do without you. You dear friend who talk so well, you can go to Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire. They can still rule the land without you. Windsor Castle will stand without you. And without much ado, we can all muddle through without you.
You brazen hussy.
Without your pulling it, the tide comes in. Without your twirling it, the earth can spin. Without your pushing them, the clouds will fall. If they can do without you, ducky, so can I. I shall not feel alone without you. I can stand on my own without you. So go back in your shell, I can do bloody well without you.
George, I really did it. I did it. I said I'd make a woman, and indeed I did. I knew that I could do it. I knew it. I said I'd make a woman and succeed. I did. Eliza, you're magnificent. 5 minutes ago, you were a millstone round my neck, and now you're a tower of strength, a consort battleship. I like you this way.
Goodbye, Professor Higgins. You shall not be seeing me again.
She's gone.
Well, of course, dear. What did you expect?
Well, what am I to do?
Do without, I suppose.
And so I shall. If the Higgins oxygen burns up her little lungs, let her seek some stuffiness that suits her. She's an owl sickened by a few days of my sunshine. Very well, let her go. I can do without her. I can do without anyone. I have my own soul. My own spark of divine fire.
Bravo, Eliza.
grown accustomed to her face. She almost makes the day begin. I've grown accustomed to the tune that she whistles night and noon. Her smiles, her frowns, her ups, her downs are second nature to me now. Like breathing out and breathing in. I was serenely independent and content before we met. Surely I could always be that way again. And yet, I've grown accustomed to her looks, accustomed to her voice, accustomed to her face. Marry Freddy. What an infantile idea. What a heartless, wicked, brainless thing to do. But she'll regret it. She'll regret it. It's doomed before they even take the vow. I can see her now, Mrs. Freddy Eynsford Hill, in a wretched little flat above a store. I can see her now, not a penny in the till and a bill collector beating at the door. She tried to teach the things I taught her and end up selling flowers instead, begging for her bread and water while her husband has his breakfast in bed. In a year or so, when she's prematurely gray and the blossom in her cheek has turned to chalk, she'll come home and lo, he'll have upped and run away with a social climbing heiress from New York. Poor Eliza. How simply frightening. How humiliating. How delightful. How poignant it'll be on that inevitable night when she hammers on my door in tears and rags. Miserable and lonely, repentant and contrite. Will I take her in or hurl her to the wolves? Give her kindness or the treatment she deserves? Will I take her back or throw the baggage out? Well, I'm a most forgiving man. The sort who never could, ever would, take a position and staunchly never budge. It's a most forgiving man. But I shall never take her back. If she were crawling on her knees, let her promise to atone, let her shiver, let her moan. I'll slam the door and let the hellcat freeze. Marry Freddy. Ah! So used to hear her say, good morning every day. Her joys, her woes, her highs, her lows are second nature to me now. Like breathing out and breathing in. I'm very grateful she's a woman, and so easy to forget. Rather like a habit one can always break. I've grown accustomed to the trace of something in the air, accustomed to her face.